realism, down to earth, or verismo, dealing with ordinary people, the characters in Cavalleria Rusticana, for instance. Or just imagine Fair City or Glen Road to beautiful music, and there you have verismo. Now, very briefly, the plot. Paris, 1900. Louise, a working-class girl, is not permitted by her parents to marry her lover, Julien, who's an artist. So she sort of runs away to live with him in Montmartre. Louise is informed by her mother that father is seriously ill and wishes to see her. Louise agrees to go home on the condition that she will be free to return to Julien. Sadly, when the father has recovered, her parents will not allow her to leave. Eventually, a violent quarrel erupts, and poor Louise is expelled from the house, leaving her father to curse Paris, the city that has stolen so much from him. Act 1, a Parisian tenement. A long window opens onto a balcony, beyond that, roofs and a bit of sky. 6 o'clock in an evening in April, and the artist Julien sings to his lover Louise, and she responds to him. Later, their voices combine. Julien's melody, in upward sweeps, is an almost exact copy of the prelude we have just heard, a sort of call to love and freedom. Listen to the brass and woodwind constantly reminding us of that love call.
Irreparable,
irreparable,
les chèvres de cette sillon
ont fini
Endearments to each other. I suppose you could call this opera Charpentier's gift to the working classes. Not only that, he had the director of the Opera Comique place 400 free tickets at the disposal of the seamstresses of Paris. I wonder if that had anything to do with poor Mimi in La Bohème. She was a seamstress. She could hardly afford to go anywhere. No? Well, then why did Charpentier himself found the Mimi Pinson Association, basically for the education of working girls? Puccini must have impressed him. Now, to the opera. Musically, Charpentier uses a number of leading motifs in his work, but these are more to do with the dramatic rather than the personal. The prelude you just heard is, how shall I call it, Julien's dramatic call to Louise. Julien is, in a sense, on the outside looking in. The opera itself opens with him, but it is the father we must watch out for. Do you remember? Boom, 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 boom. At the end of the prelude, that little motif refers to him. It's in the minor key. Listen out for it. Parisian slums, by the way, don't have much room between them. One house and another, they're very close. Julien lives in the opposite terrace. Louise asks him to tell her, in detail, just how and when his love for her began. Of course she already knows. This is for our benefit, the audience. Julien tells her that one day he discovered that he had Louise for a neighbor, a girl in a sort of prison, great wondering eyes, ignorant of the world, overprotective parents. He, a poet, turning his dreams into verse, suddenly realized that his dreams had come true. These dreams came true when he stumbled upon her one night in the dim light of the staircase. Evermore, his fate was sealed. Just as their duet reaches its climax of ardor, the orchestra answers with a motif of Louise's own passion. But they're interrupted. Listen out for Louise's mother. Julien, at last, restates his love call for Louise, a call you'll now recognize.
che votre joliere viene surbrata.
Mais vous, que de vous taire, vous faut-il que j'aille votre reine
I think you can gather by now that the parents don't approve of Julien. You see, Louise is a sweet, lovely girl caught in that awful love trap between parents and the natural love instincts of a young and beautiful girl. Scene 4. Louise's mother is not sympathetic and hates artists. Good for nothing, she calls them. Suddenly, steps are heard outside. Father enters to a figure derived from his own motif I sang earlier. Remember? Da dee da ba bum bo bum bum. And he comes in. He's a very sympathetic figure, an old world, honest to God workman of good character. He has in his hand a letter from Julien, which was handed to him as he was coming in. He sits by the stove, reads it, looks to Louise, holds out his arms. Louise falls into them and kisses him. The love bond between father and daughter is very strong, not so with mother. His feelings towards Louise and her problems are expressed in a tender phrase of the orchestra, 6-8 and 9-8. It's a childlike tenderness, woodwind foremost, with a pulsating violin accompaniment. The little family sit down to a meal of soup. Father says he's growing old and tired.
Bonsoir. La soupe est prête.
Oui, de suite.
Thank you.
belle journée.
Tu es fatigué.
Je sens que je ne suis plus jeune et les journées sont longues.
Pauvre père, tu ne te reposeras donc jamais.
Et qui ferait bouillir la marmite si je quittais l'outil?
The second act opens with an orchestral prelude and is called Paris Awakes. You see, it's not Julien alone, but Paris that is tugging at the girl's heart. The orchestral prelude is, how shall I say, woven together like a fabric of three motifs, held together with a low D natural, which we feel all the way through. We still hear it even when the gentle harp blinks it away. Then, this surely must have influenced Stravinsky's Rite of Spring in 1913, especially when you listen to the cor anglais. The city finally awakes, and we hear celebrations of melody everywhere. Then all stirrings finally die away. The curtain rises, and we see a crossroads at the foot of the hill of Montmartre. Two, scene three, a street scene in Paris. All the vendors are peddling their wares, a sort of musical Henry Street and Moore Street combined. All the voices mingle in a sort of sweet confusion, the unmistakable buzz of a big city. It might even remind you of Lionel Barthes' Oliver. Do you remember the street scene, the opening moments of Who Will Buy?
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Comment vas-tu? Nous sommes en avance.
Il est 8 heures.
Oh. Eh bien, tu t'es amusé hier?
Ah, ce que j'ai dit.
Tu sais, le grand Léon.
Julien is trying desperately to see Louise alone, but she's with her mother, who tells her that Paris is not good for her, and from now on she'll work from home. Cold kisses are exchanged between them. The mother goes away, looking round suspiciously for any signs of Julien. When the coast is clear, Julien runs out, drags the agitated Louise to the shed, and begs her not to become a slave in her own home. Poor Louise is so torn between her father and her lover, you can feel her sadness in the orchestral prelude, as the melody also saddens, weeps for her in those falling sixths.
Thank you.
Here in Scene 1, Act 3, again those sad falling sixths announce her love cry for Julien, and he answers her in short endearments. Depuis les jours, to me, is the tenderest melody in the whole opera. Louise has made her heartbreaking choice. A great row breaks out between father and daughter, and he throws her out, but regrets it at once. The lights of the town suddenly die down. Louise has gone. The room looks dark and empty. Her father's rage has burnt itself out. He runs to the stairs and calls, "Louise! Louise!" But there's no answer. He stumbles back slowly, clutching at the furniture for support, thinking he hears Louise returning. He looks eagerly towards the door again, but she's gone, this time forever. He shakes a sad, impotent fist at the Paris that has robbed him of his baby girl, everything he lived for. So, on that sad note, we come to the end of tonight's programme, and I leave you with Louise, beloved Louise, singing Depuis les jours, ever since the day. Good night.
Soon! Aspects of Opera was presented by Ted Courtney and produced by John Hughes. Next week, Ted will discuss Mozart's Don Giovanni.